Hi, it's Warren Huart here. Hope you're doing marvellously well. I'm sitting here with the great Evan Beigel. How are you, mate?
Very good, Warren. Thank you.
Good to see you. So we're here in your home studio, and we've already been talking rock and roll horror stories.
That's right.
Good way to break the ice is to talk some rock and roll horror stories. Yes. And some good stuff. You were telling me about working in Brazil.
That's right. Back in, I think it would have been 2001, I went to Brazil to record an amazing world music artist named Bagia Sage.
Fantastic.
And she's a nylon string acoustic performer and vocal percussionist. And she's got tons of classical guitar albums, and she's got a handful of
How did you get hooked up with her?
Through another producer, actually, that had worked with her, a guy by the name of Pat Regan, who he's been around for a long time. He's worked with Deep Purple and bands like Warrant, who ironically used to make fun of Warrant when I was in college, and then they ended up in my studio facility, and they were really nice guys, and I kind of felt bad about making fun of their music.
I think probably for our age group, especially if we were making records in the 90s, we always laughed at the 80s bands.
Yes.
And I'm sure the 80s bands were laughing at the 70s bands. Yeah. And it's,
The irony was is that they were such great players, I wasn't finding myself making fun of their studio prowess because they really knew what they were doing. But Pat Regan was the guy that introduced me to Baji, and it actually was a fortune of good luck for me because he was supposed to do the gig and he got booked on another gig, and he trusted my work and he made the recommendation and they hired me. So that was good.
That's fantastic. Well, that's a great little tip. Have great relationships with other producers.
Absolutely. It's definitely a business of relationships. And not only will you learn a lot from great producers and know where the bar is, because if you don't know where the bar is, you're not working with somebody great. You'll never know what great actually is, because it's very much a subjective art form.
Yeah, I talk a lot about mentorships. And I think they're probably more, from my perspective, having worked with people and what I've learned. I don't think, maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think anybody that's been a mentor for me has ever sat down and go, I'm going to mentor this young lad. I think that they've just become our mentors because we work with them, for them, around them, whatever it might be, and we pick up stuff, and they become mentors to us.
That's right. And the good ones are very generous with their tips and their feedback, and they're not insecure about giving studio secrets, as you like to call them. They're free with their information.
I agree. I'll give, people ask me questions all the time and I'll just tell them exactly how I did it.
Right.
Because it's giving somebody the tools, giving somebody the knowledge, still doesn't mean they're going to do it exactly the same way as you.
That's right.
You know? I mean, it would be foolish not to because, we can all buy the same equipment.
That's right.
But it's a funny business where we still get people getting very protective like that. But I don't think it works anymore. I don't think that works because we have to have relationships with other people in order to be able to be successful. And I think that the better the community is for all of us, the better it is for all of us.
Absolutely. And it's 100% the reason that I was able to learn the things that I've learned is because I was around generous people who knew what they were doing.
So you told me earlier you're from Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
Did you have a studio in Chicago?
No, I didn't get into studio work until I moved out here. I grew up in Chicago. I went to school south of Chicago, traditional music education, and I just loved the idea of going into a recording studio and making music. So while I was actually in college, I came to LA during a couple of summers and just went into the studio and just recorded some of my own material with just staff folks. And
which studio?
I'm trying to remember. There was one in North Hollywood that was owned by an artist, if I'm remembering, his name was Baraka. And I don't know if he's around anymore, and I can't remember the name of the studio, which
is pretty sad
because it was literally the first studio that I had ever been in, and I'm blanking on the name. But it was Baraka's studio. They had a Trident B console in there, which I didn't know what it was at the time, but I was just enamored with the whole environment.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
What was the medium? Were you going to tape in those days?
Yep, that was tape. So I just caught the last little piece of analog tape, so to speak. I was fortunate in that way as well to be able to see what recording to analog tape was like.
Now, as a keyboard player, were you always, were you tinkering with early DAWs yourself, sequencing and all that kind of stuff?
My first sequencer was Cubase. On an Atari 1040 ST with 1 megabyte of RAM.
I know it well. So you didn't start on the 520?
What's that?
You didn't start on the 520.
Did not. My dad had, you know, one of those little Yamaha two-channel sequencer, essentially. Mm-hmm. It had two buttons on it, but I never really got into it. He kind of was into it. He had a DX7, and I got into that a little bit.
DX7, wow.
That's right. So that's kind of what got me into keyboards. But my first keyboard was the Korg. My first personal keyboard was the Korg M1.
Oh, and great keyboard.
Yeah, and then I moved on from that to a T3, and that was like my first workstation. And then I picked up an Ensoniq SQ1, I think it was. I'm having trouble remembering, but
oh, it's quite right.
Yeah,
without stopping you there for a second, the M1 to me was like, yeah, that was a flagship keyboard. Yeah. I remember when that came out, it was like the first time you heard like piano samples and stuff. You're like, wow, this actually sounds like a piano.
Yeah.
It didn't sound like a synthesized version of anything.
Right.
And even when the O1Rs and the O1RWs came out, they just sounded like the M1 with a few extra features. Right. It was relatively expensive, but it was one of the most affordable high-end keyboards I ever heard.
Yeah.
You know, we're talking early 90s.
It was,
that was an amazing keyboard.
Yeah. Amazing.
Yeah, really good. I wonder if you do still have one?
I don't, sadly. I moved on from them. And I'm not a guy that likes to just, you know, sell off gear, but, you know, right, with some certain pieces of gear, they're not, I guess, that keepable, if you will. And I just moved on to some other things.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, I didn't keep them.
So you've got tons of fun stuff in here we can talk about. Now, not being a keyboard player myself, what I like is that you actually have lots of fun little keyboard stuff.
Yes.
Which is great, because that's more the sort of thing as a guitar player I would gravitate towards.
Yep.
Like, just pick up for a second. Pick up these little toys that you were telling me about. They're not toys, yes, they're instruments.
They are.
Awesome.
There's a whole set.
These things are great.
Yeah. They look like little calculators. Actually, you can buy their circuit boards, you know, so holding them is kind of a little bit funky, but they actually make cases for each one of these, because some people hold it and go, oh, I'm holding a circuit board, I need to get a case or something.
Right.
But I'm perfectly fine having it just like this. But yeah, these things cost $60 each, and they're little step sequencers. Each one has 16 steps on it, and they all make these little sounds. This one's called Rhythm, and so naturally it's got rhythm-oriented sounds.
What's the name of the company?
It's called Teenage Engineering.
Teenage Engineering.
Yeah. And they make all kinds of really unique and crazy stuff. So they make these little synthesizers, and you can hook up a little cable here, output, input, and you can sync them all together using Jam Sync. And you can even take an adapter from your DAW, put it in the input here, and that will synchronize all of them to whatever tempo you have in DAW. It's great. And they run on batteries. Totally portable. You can plug headphones into here, get a little bit more of a visceral sound, or you can just use the little built-in speaker that it has, which is actually not too bad.
I like it because I have, you know, I'm sure you do as well, on my iPad and my iPhone, I have iMachine and all that stuff, mm-hmm, which is fantastic. But no matter anything we do in touchscreen, I love it, and the Raven, you know, think about getting a Raven. I love all of this stuff.
Yeah.
But there's nothing better than actually, excuse me,
yeah,
having a tactile button you can press.
Oh, yeah.
Where you feel, that's going to be tough to,
yep,
to change.
And I think these days, it's actually, I mean, you see all these little synthesizers, if you will, coming out. You see that they're getting less expensive. Like, I've got some keyboards over there that cost $500, whereas you can never get a synthesizer, you know, 20 years ago for $500.
I mean, how much are these little Yamahas?
Yeah, those are $499 each. So with tax, you know, $540, $550, and they sound amazing, they're tactile, and they do amazing things. They give you all kinds of creativity. But the whole point you were making about a tactile surface, I think with all the software that's come on the market, I think there's just a yearning for that, because
I agree,
it's quite unsatisfying.
Yeah, it's, you know, there's a whole discussion about mixing in the box, mixing through consoles. I do both.
Yep.
I tend to sort of figure out what's the best thing for the song. But the more I do this, the more I moved further and further, closer and closer, sorry, further away from consoles and closer to mixing in the box. Because I feel like the technology is getting super advanced. But the one thing I miss is that.
Right.
Is, you know, some of the misconceptions with studio equipment, like if you buy, know, there's a fantastic tools out there, for instance, that have mic pres and compressors and EQs and everything built into them. But they literally have 25 buttons and switches on the front. But you and I know if you go to, you know, Sunset Sound or United or something like that, you know, the compressors there are usually two knobs.
Yep.
The EQs are like three controls. And the reason for that is you just kind of want that experience of just turning something. Oh, it's brighter. Okay, keep moving.
That's right.
You're not sitting there spending an hour trying to figure out something.
Exactly. That TLA, Summit TLA 100 right there, that's a perfect example of what you just mentioned. That compressor has two knobs and, what is that, five switches? So there's not a whole lot of...
No variable attack and release, just fast and slow.
Exactly. It just gives you, you know, make a choice. It's very musical sounding. It can be very subtle or you can be kind of aggressive with it and it's easy.
I have a love for these because Brian Kolstrom, my old friend who unfortunately died a couple of years ago, he made some amazing records and he had all Summit audio stuff. Him and Dave Jordan, big fans of Summit. And I think that their compressors are fantastic sounding.
Amazing sounding.
I see you have the Brent Averill, the BAE pres up there.
Uh-huh. Those are great. Sound great. Very musical EQ. Those are those EQs that you can put them anywhere and they sound good. It's just what flavor of greatness do you want? So it makes it easy.
Yeah, it's a sort of, for me, it's the 1073 in particular is kind of the sound of rock and roll for me.
Yeah. Absolutely.
It's a snare drum that you know the sound of. It's an electric guitar you know the sound of.
Definitely.
This is one of the first things I noticed when I came in. You have a Dimension D.
That's right. World's greatest sounding chorus.
Wow.
I have to say, I'm definitely biased. I've never heard a better sounding chorus. And it just works on things that you'd never think to use it on. And again, so simple because you've got four options.
Yeah.
And you just... Which one do you like?
That's fantastic.
Not, you know, and these software programs, there's just so many. I'm definitely not a believer in having too many options. And when recording, you know, it's like, I think the thing to do these days, people believe as well, just record a whole bunch of takes and then figure out what to do with them later. And I'm just, because, and it might be because I caught that last bit of analog that I'm not like this, is that more commitment oriented. Anytime you can make a commitment. And I think guitar players, at least the ones that I know, they are this way as well, is they like committing to their tone. And I think with recording, it's an important step to take because making commitment shows up in the recording, I believe.
I agree entirely. I just I'm making a record with an artist at the moment, and he wanted a mixer to take a stab at one of the songs that was going to be the single. And I was like, sure, you know, let's have a different guy mix it. And the guy called me and said, oh, do you have a vocal without any compression on it? And I was like, I mean, I recorded it with light compression, you know, it's a pretty fat, even tone. And he's a younger guy and he never really worked with stuff that was committed.
Right.
We actually committed to a sound.
Right.
And I was actually, Connor, who's filming here, he and I were talking about this yesterday. It's like these kids, and they're leaving messages. And I say kids, that's not entirely true, but people that are going to modern schools now are leaving messages saying, oh, we're just taught to pretty much like put a mic up and just record it flat and then figure it all out in mixing.
Yeah.
And the feeling I've been getting talking to a lot of guys, like talking to Chris Algie recently, he was saying he's just getting massive track counts. Everything is just completely, you know, sonically doesn't work together. It's just recorded, and then it's kind of his job to sift through hundreds of tracks sometimes and figure out how they will relate to each other. And that's a difficult one because then it becomes like the mixer becomes the other producer.
That's right.
Which is fine, you know, I it's part of the job, you know, our jobs, even whether we're hired as a keyboard player or guitar player, engineer, producer, or mixer, our job is to make it great.
Yep.
And I always tell people, I have made so many records as a quote-unquote engineer and ended up producing the session, but do I have a resentment? No, because my job is to make great music. I'm not going to be a job's worth, as we call it in England, or what's that phrase in America where you're just like, no, I'm not going to do that because... that's not above my pay grade, you know.
Apathetic, but I don't know what the phrase is.
Yeah, exactly.
But you're up against that a lot,
yeah,
especially in this kind of work.
Yeah, to me, it's like, that's, you know, that's just do, and the reason why I feel like I may, you know, have progressed is because I've always given it my best. And if that means I'm going in there rewriting all the guitar parts with the guitar player, but I'm the engineer, then that's what I do. I've done that on any record, you know. Anyway, enough about me. Let's talk about you.
No, that's okay.
So you have the iMachine.
The machine is, I mean, it's great for...
The machine. I don't like to call it the iMachine.
No, that's the actual machine. Yeah, you can get the iPad version of course. It's, I mean, that's just a controller. You know, the software is in the computer. But it's cool because you can make beats with it, so to speak, in a pretty musical way. And it does appeal to folks that maybe aren't able to play an instrument. But it's set up like an instrument, so you can play it like one by using the pads as an instrument. And it's got a nice little workflow to it. And it's actually something I've just been experimenting with on electronic music. And I like it. It's not something that I love, but I like it. I still end up in my DAW after the fact, manipulating the crap out of what I've made and chopping it all up and doing other things with it. And because I have so many live drum recordings that I've made, you know, I've got a lot of assets that I can use, so to speak, to create different types of beats and things like that.
Yeah, I wonder a lot. This is the latest one, is it? Because it's white.
Yeah. They make them in black as well. You know, I just thought the white was kind of cool.
No, it's cool. I like it.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know a few people that love the software. Like, love the software and love the... You know, I have it on the iPhone and the iPad. And it's great for planes.
Yep.
You're sitting on a plane. You're absolutely bored. You're trapped. Sometimes there's no...
Yeah.
The Wi-Fi, and you're like, oh, let's make some music. And I've written songs and ideas that I've gone back and built on. And again, it's that sort of thing where you can play. So, you know, it's great that it has pads. I wondered, I'd love to see people have a discussion on this, because I'm thinking about, you know, having something like this for myself, and I don't know which is the best one to go for.
Yeah, it's a good one. I mean, it's definitely, and it integrates really well with all the other native instruments stuff that they make. Like, if you're a Kontakt user, for example, there's lots of cool things that you can do with this in Kontakt.
And it sort of appeals to the MPC kind of brain.
Yeah.
I grew up on MPCs.
That's true. Of course, the MPC guys seem to be, you know, they seem to be folks that won't use anything except MPC gear. But that's right. It is. Definitely a beat maker's tool, because the workflow is set up in such a way that it just caters to that. Now, Ableton has their push controller, which is very cool as well, but that's very well integrated into Live, Ableton Live, which is a whole other way of making music.
That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, a lot of kids, literally kids, like up-and-coming guys now, just make everything on Ableton.
Yeah.
I'm seeing a lot of...
I think it's because it helps you... I'm not going to say that it composes music for you, but I think it helps you. It helps your creative flow. If you're not the type of person that's used to making something completely from scratch, it sort of leads you in a way that will result in quick creative results, which is nice. You know, it's nice for folks.
Especially for guys like me that are actually guitar players and not keyboard players.
Well, that's, I mean, yes, it can definitely help in that regard. But I think it's, you know, I think, as you mentioned, the younger folks, it's getting them into recording. The downside is that because it does things for you, you tend to not work as hard if you're using those things. And then you wonder in the end why your stuff doesn't sound like, you know, like Katy Perry stuff, for example. If you're making a beat, it's like, you know, her producers beats, you know, when you listen to those and then, you know, you compare your stuff to theirs, a lot of times you can feel insignificant but you forget that the work that they went through to create that sonic experience that you're hearing is very extensive, and they're not doing it in one place, like on a machine or on Ableton Live.
But then there's other times that you and I know where you turn on the radio and you're like, wow, that's preset number two.
Exactly. Yeah.
I've had that experience a lot over the years where I've just... And, you know, even I did a Mattis Yahoo song that Bruno Mars wrote a long time ago. And before Bruno became successful, and he told me he did everything on the first record on a Triton. Mm. So all of the drum sounds, all of the programming, everything was just on a Triton. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it's if you've got a creative brain and you're as talented as somebody as Bruno Mars, you can take... one device, like he could take this and go away with a microphone, because he's obviously an incredible singer, and make an album that would blow our minds. Because he already did. That's how he made his first record. So it's great what we have. Now, this I see a lot and I know nothing about, and it confuses me because there's no writing on it except for numbers.
Yeah, that's another piece by Teenage Engineering.
Oh, it's the same company.
Same company. That's the OP1. This is actually what put the company on the map. This little synthesizer is extremely powerful. You can make a whole track on that little synth, and
wow,
it's obviously portable. You can charge it with a USB cable plugged into a computer. And it's again, it's just a very creative, unique tool. This thing actually functions as a radio antenna as well. So you can actually, you know, if you're in an area where you're going to receive radio waves, it'll actually take that in, and you can record it as part of your little thing that you're making, which is pretty wild.
That is.
Yeah.
That's so Brian Eno. It's ridiculous.
Yeah. And it's got these other things where you can, when you move it up and down, it's got, what do you call it, an accelerometer in there, which manipulates the sound. So you can actually pull up a sound and you can manipulate it with modulation simply by moving the instrument up and
fantastic.
Down.
Fantastic.
It's got this little speaker on it. So again, portable. But when you plug it in, it sounds like a formidable synth. And I think people see it and they realize, wow, that thing's $850. Why would I pay $850 for that? But when you get into it, you realize that it's a lot of synthesizer in a small little package.
But it is $850.
It is. Yeah.
Now, you can put a vocal mic in there?
Yep, plug a vocal mic in. There's a little red input right here that you can record any signal into there. And it'll allow you.
I love the radio waves thing because... Yeah. I think of My Life of Bush of Ghosts, Eno with...
Right. It just does all kinds of crazy stuff. This doesn't really do it justice once it's plugged in the sound.
What do you mean, this absolutely massive speaker here of about 3/4 of an inch?
That's right. Yeah.
That's fantastic. Now, you're using the Command 8 there?
That is just for some tactile fader control of Pro Tools. Yeah, right. I've had this thing forever. So
now we should get into, we're sort of moving left to right here. Let's finish off our right, getting over to right here. And then, so here's the dangerous remote, which I don't know, but one of my good friends, Bob Marlette, is a dangerous fan.
So in the absence of a console, you know, you got to have a master section, and that's what this is. It acts as a speaker switcher. It acts as an attenuator for the system, and you can input a lot of different signals in it. You can feed headphones. It controls this box right here. Dangerous Music, to me, is a very transparent-sounding manufacturing company, and for me, the best place to have transparency is at the point of the speakers. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't want to be so transparent when it came to my mix bus, which is why I have something more colorful in this burl, because, you know, Dangerous does make mix buses as well, and, you know, the transparency there was something that I really didn't want. I wanted transparency to be at the monitoring point, but then I've got colorful items that I can use when creating the final sound. Yeah,
I've heard a lot about the burl. I have a couple of friends that really like it, and I remember when I was mixing Aerosmith, we ended up using the burl on a couple of the tracks because we had used class, we'd come off tape into Pro Tools, mm-hmm. so we got a lot of warmth. And then there was a couple of things that we didn't.
Right.
And we're coming back going, oh, okay, here's definitely recorded on tape sound, here's definitely not recorded on tape. And it was mainly the drums that just had that extra, whatever the word is, digital correctness, which is not a bad thing, just very accurate, mm-hmm. and didn't have that sort of like transience being pulled in by tape. So the burl, just, you know, with a couple of things. It has transformers in it, so it obviously had some weight, but it just kind of sucked up the transience a little bit and made it feel, this is contentious, but made it feel a little bit more like tape.
Yep.
So it got our mixes, you know, the one or two songs that weren't, the drums weren't recorded on tape, suddenly started to feel like, or closer to the ones that were.
Yeah.
So I have a lot of respect for it.
I'm a huge fan of that device. Before this, I was using a Sony DMX-R100 console. The console broke down, and it's an older digital console. So it was getting harder to have repaired, harder to find parts. Sony doesn't support the console anymore, but there is a company down in West LA that still works on them and fixes them. And it was just getting a little cumbersome having to take the whole thing out of this rig and be down for the whole time, getting this huge piece of gear over there. And so I was, at that point, I was just kind of like, you know, I'm in a home studio. I'm not going to use a console anymore, but I am going to use a variety of different things that will give the same feel that I was getting with a console, which was essentially summing and with some equalization and compression because it has it on every channel. But I was essentially using that console as a summing mixer. So I felt like, okay, well, instead of having this big console, I'm going to get a really good summing mixer. I demoed a lot of different summing mixers, and this one was just the one that I liked the best. And for all the reasons that you said, it's got a lot of nice saturation features to it and sounds to it. You can overdrive it, and it sounds really good by adding this 6 dB gain. It's got two different transformers. It's got the BX5, and then when you pop these out, it has its, I'm not sure what it's called, but its other transformer. And then that allows you to get two slightly different tones on the mix bus. Yeah.
Now, let's move down here. This is loud and small.
Yeah, so this... I love SSL, and I use this as my master bus compression. So this is the last line of defense, if you will, before the mix gets recorded. So I can't afford an SSL console, but I was able to afford this. So at least I have two channels of SSL compression.
I have an SSL console, yeah. And I can't afford it.
It's
electricity
not,
bills, you know, I had to prove in national debt.
Oh, man. If I had my druthers and had unlimited, you know, disposable, I won't say unlimited, but more disposable income, I would definitely have the AWS SSL console. Like, I think those are amazing. I love them. Yeah.
Great. Yeah. I have a 4,000 electricity bills through the roof. Sounds great, but...
I'm sure. Yeah.
But that, I mean, I'm doing more and more mixing in the box and just using elements of it where I need it.
Yeah.
I'm just doing whatever sounds the best.
Yeah.
Sometimes that's in the box entirely, and sometimes that's hybrid.
Well, I think, as you alluded to before, you know, if you have an ear, you know, you can make anything sound very convincing and intentional. And I think just knowing what you want is a big part of that. So if you have limited gear, knowing what you want is going to get you the rest of the way.
This is something which is just coming up in my mind recently. We talk about film and we talk about audio in the same way. You know, a lot of stuff now is shot entirely on digital. A lot of stuff is recorded on digital. And we spend our whole lives trying to make it look analog, whether it be simulating 35 millimeter film or 2-inch tape. I just wonder out loud if I was a 18-year-old kid going to college now without those preconceived ideas.
Yep.
Without being told this is the way it's supposed to sound, what would they do? And what should they do?
Well, that's the thing. They have to be into it enough to seek out those answers. So I taught audio production for a few years, and I did find that the younger folks coming in were very unexposed, for lack of a better word, of what recording was all about. They felt like, well, if I can pull up a preset on a keyboard, or if I can go into a computer, into GarageBand, pull up a couple of presets, well, this is what recording's all about. And they put something together, and then they listen to their stuff, and then they listen to stuff done by professionals who have been working at their craft for a few decades, and they feel deficient all of a sudden. And then some of them give up. Others want to seek out why they're deficient. And those are the ones that actually show interest in the hobby, if you will. They want to get into it. And then their plight and their challenge at that point is being able to find somebody who, you know, somebody that I had that you mentioned, like a mentor or mentors who are working at a very high level. So you know where that bar is. So at least you know what you're shooting for. Because if you're just referencing professional tracks, you may never know how to get there. But if you're working with somebody that actually knows how to do that, you're going to pick up the information that you need to at least give you an idea and the tools to get you there.
Great. Well, hopefully we can do a little bit of this by talking about it. Yeah. I also wonder, one of the questions that's posed to that I'm sort of posing is if we didn't impose preconceived ideas and expectations on people coming up, I wonder what they would do. You know, without going, oh, I need to get, you know, I wonder how they would come to those same results. You understand what I mean?
Because
we're sort of saying film and tape is the way to go, and all we're doing is trying to simulate it. I wonder now if it's just based on the ear of like, I want this to sound really good, but without that sort of preconceived notion of like, well, it just has to simulate tape. I wonder what's, because it's going to happen, because we're all going to get older.
Yeah.
And we're all going to retire. Or drop dead eventually, you know.
Yeah.
And guys are going to, they're going to go back and listen to Zeppelin. They're going to go back and listen to the Beatles, and they're going to listen to Motown and jazz. and early classical recordings and hear just this incredible sound.
Yep.
And I wonder if we're going to move past this, the dogma of analog, and it just be part of the process. So an EQ sounds like an EQ. It doesn't right. have to be a simulation of a vintage EQ. It's just that's the way EQ should sound. You know what I mean? I wonder.
Yeah, that's a great question. I've never actually thought about it that way. I've just kind of hoped that young folks, if they're interested, they sort of seek out the way that, and sure. this is true with any art form, I think, is that you look at what your predecessors have done before you. You try to learn Absolutely. How they did that, and then you look at what you have available and you reference, and then by referencing, you start to turn it into your own thing just
Beautiful, yeah.
naturally.
I agree.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's innovation. For me, yeah. it was like I was a kid, I heard blues rock guitar players and rock guitar players, and I was like, oh, that's really cool. And then I wanted to know, well, who's this Robert Johnson guy they're talking about?
Right.
So you go back and you buy the, you know, the whatever, the 20 or 30 songs that he recorded, and you hear that, and then you find out why the Stones and Zeppelin, why they created their version of, you know, rhythm and blues.
Yeah.
Who they stole from, what blues artists they stole from. And I love that voyage of discovery, because out of that, you bring yourself to it and you right. twist it, you know, because there's no way Zeppelin sounds like Robert Johnson. But right. without Robert Johnson, there's no Led Zeppelin.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yep.
Great. Well, wonderful. Thanks yeah. for a little indulging me on that.
No,
discussion.
No, of course. It's. I'm still thinking about it, thinking about that, going, well, is analog ever going to leave the conversation or the quest for analog, or is it going to get good enough so that it leaves the conversation? I mean, obviously, I think sample rate in digital audio has a lot to do with it. And, you know, I'm still personally working in 48K or 44.1 even.
I'm a 48K.
And it's one of those things where it's like, yeah, can I work in 96K? Yes, but then I lose some D to A converters, and then sometimes my system doesn't work correctly, and it feels like they haven't quite gotten it to the spot yet where it's actually standard, if you will. Some people are doing it, but there's plenty of other people that aren't and still making stuff sound great. And clearly in the analog days, this wasn't even a conversation. But if they can get, you know, everybody working at 192K, well, maybe there's a sonic difference, but you still have to have the intent and the ear in order to make stuff sound convincing and great. And you can have all the analog gear in the world and still not make something very good. So it's just kind of...
One thing yeah. I will say, sorry if I'm getting too esoteric here, yep. but I think this is important. You know, I read Bob Lefsetz and I appreciate what he says and I agree with him a lot of the times. But then one of the things I don't agree with is, and I don't agree with this on all audiophiles, they're all knocking, you know, the way that, oh, you know, people are listening on iPhones and listening on laptops. Yeah, they are.
Yeah.
But you know what? I don't know about you, but I'm old enough, and it's not that long ago.
Yeah.
You know how I used to listen to music 99% of the day? On an AM radio through one yeah. crappy little speaker.
Yeah.
And the only reason why you could recognize the song is because I went home and put the vinyl on and listened to the song, or the CD as when it came out, and then I listened to...
Yeah.
So when people get critical and say, oh, you know, MP3s suck, it's like, really?
Yeah.
You know what? Listening on my iPhone is a yeah. thousand times, with a pair of earbuds, I don't care what anybody wants to tell me, is a thousand times better than all of the 40-plus-year-old guys grew up listening. Because 40-plus-year-old
yeah.
guys, we all grew up listening on AM radios.
Yeah.
And then maybe an FM radio boombox. But I'm telling you, I'll fight anybody on this. It's ridiculous. It's like
yeah.
this iPhone with a pair of earbuds sounds so much better than the way I grew up. So,
yeah.
So I think that, you know, we can, it's like, yeah, you go home in the perfectly acoustically treated room with the big Awaya speakers and
right.
the hi-fi, but that wasn't how we listened.
Yeah.
You know, I think
You're
for
right.
the average consumer yeah. now, life is better.
Yeah. And I agree. It's more convenient.
It yeah. sounds better.
Yeah.
And this illusion that we rose-tinted spectacles way that everybody was listening on incredible 70s speakers and acoustically treated room with vinyl and $10,000
yeah.
hi-fis. It wasn't like that.
Yeah.
That was like 8 people out of a million.
Yeah.
The rest of us were AM radios, crappy boomboxes, cassettes.
Yep. Yeah.
A cassette was better than an MP3, really?
Yeah. Well, the irony is that there's a cassette player in here.
Yep.
And this thing is, the purpose this serves now is that's an effects box for us. I just think people have gotten spoiled and people want to poke holes and everything. And there's not so many audiophiles these days anymore. That's the only thing that I see that's kind of disappointing about the convenience of the way music is disseminated. And maybe it comes from people not realizing the value of music or wanting to pay for it, which I think is a generational thing. And I think it's just education. Like, people need to learn. But there are an amazing number of people that will sit on iTunes and try to seek out music that's not being spoon-fed to them because it's out on the top of the charts, or it's like being pushed front and center and that sort of thing, which I think is still encouraging, because that at least means that people want to find music that they like.
Absolutely. I think we make music for everybody. So, yeah. You know,
yeah.
I want people to hear the music that we make, and whatever way that is, whether it's Spotify or Pandora, iTunes, or YouTube, which is the number one way people listen to that music.
Yeah.
You know, God bless it.
Yeah.
I really do. And, you know, there's so many avenues open, and it's just really, you know, whether we want to take them and work hard to get our stuff out there.
Yeah.
But having this whole audiophile conversation, let's direct to your way of recording.
Sure. Well, I talked about the last line of defense, which was this Alan Smart SSL piece. The first line of defense is this guy right here, which is an IS Technology Radar 24, and it's being displayed up there. The actual box itself is in a machine room over there. It's a totally self-contained digital hard disk recorder, but I don't use it as a recorder anymore. I use Pro Tools as my recorder, but what this does is this acts as my A to D converter. So anything that gets recorded goes through this. Analog signal gets converted to digital and then is digitally transported over to the Pro Tools interfaces. And so that's where it ends up. And then on the way back out, when I'm mixing in Pro Tools, doing a final mix, it actually comes back digitally from Pro Tools to the radar. And then from the radar, D to A, to the Burl, and then the Burl to this device right here, the Alan Smart. And then that gets recorded back into Pro Tools, A to D, going back through the radar one last time.
And you love the sound of those converters.
I love the sound of the converters, which is why I still have that radar, because I'm not really using it as a recorder anymore. So all I really need are the converters. So that's why I still have it, because the converters are what I like it.
I was about to say, I mean, that's essentially what the radar is converters, because the only other thing was storage.
That's right.
Yeah.
Before I had Pro Tools, this was my recording device, and I had two of these. So we had 48 tracks of radar, and that's what I was recording to for a long time when I had my commercial studio. This was before I got Pro Tools, and I kind of went into Pro Tools kicking and screaming because I wanted to continue using the radar, but I had clients coming in that wanted Pro Tools for obvious reasons, and people were telling me, well, you're really fast with that radar, but you realize that all that editing you just did on there, you could probably do in, you know, about 10% of the time that it just took you on Pro Tools if you just got Pro Tools. And fortunately, I had a lot of nice folks. I was surrounded by a lot of nice folks, and they were very subtle because they knew how much I loved the radar. They were very subtle in telling me that I really needed to get Pro Tools if I wanted to continue being a studio owner, because
you were talking, people were
going to stop coming in if I didn't get Pro Tools, basically.
Yeah. Now, you were talking earlier about Brian Lucy, who you'd used recently for mastering, and you loved what he was doing. He's obviously really well known for doing all the Black Keys stuff.
That's right.
And of course, the Black Keys are very well known for recording on radar.
That's right. Yeah. Yep. I'm a big fan of the way the Black Keys stuff sounds. I'm a big fan of the way Sting stuff sounds, who has used radar. I'm a huge fan of the way the Seal records sound, and they used radar. So it's like there's a lot of artists whose records that I really, really enjoy the sound of, and then I come to find out that they've done some recording on radar.
Now, the thing I get from people that love radar is the depth that they feel that they had in tape that they feel like is missing in digital. I'm not an expert. Do you have any theories as to why that might be? Why it has that greater depth?
Well, I have a theory, but it's not my theory. I think it's actually based on something that the folks at Radar, at IS Technology, explained to me. They explained that it has to do with where the A to D conversion is taking place once it actually gets to the box, whether it's taking place on what they refer to as the front end or whether it's taking place on the back end. I'm not an electrical engineer, so on the surface, I have no idea like what any of that means. I take their word for it. I also believe that they have, you know, proprietary secrets that they don't want to let out about how they build their stuff. But what I would say is absolutely 100% true. When I was turned on to the radar, which again, this was another thing that Pat Regan, producer who I mentored with for a long time, he turned me on to these devices, and that was precisely his comment. He was like, well, this is the most analog sounding digital recorder that I know of. And he didn't really have any kind of electrical engineering or manufacturing reason why. He just felt like the high end was better, it was softer, it was more expansive sounding, the spread between the tracks was more evident, it didn't sound boxed in like some people would refer to an in the box sound, sort of has this sort of narrow stereo field, for example, whereas when you get something out of the box, it starts to spread out a little bit, you feel like you have more space in the stereo spectrum. Whether that's placebo or not, I guess I'm falling for it, because I definitely believe that to be true. I definitely believe that I get a wider sounding recording when I'm using this A to D conversion versus strictly being in Pro Tools, for example.
Now, when I was at AES, I was at the BAE booth, and next door was the radar booth. And they were showing, it was very loud there, so I didn't get a chance to really get into it. But they were showing me now that they have a properly integrated system for radar with Pro Tools. Are you going to get that?
I've heard it. Well, no, I'm not going to get that because, I mean, I would like to have it, but for me, it's really just a function of, you know, not having the disposable income to buy that. I mean, just to get this transported over to A to D converters only would mean I'd have to buy another box, take the cards out and put it in there, and that's that's like a $5,000 investment. It would be great for me to have Pro Tools and radar in one box, because obviously I'm using Pro Tools and radar. I'm just not there yet, you know, as far as having the income to do that. But if I did, I absolutely would, because it doesn't really make sense to have two systems when I'm using them together anyway.
I see. Yeah. Well, it seems to be... So we were having a sort of anti-audiophile conversation a second ago, where we were just saying that people that are critical of like MP3s is pretty hilarious, because we all grew up on AM radio and boomboxes. But it's interesting, because then guys like you and Brian and who produces the Black Keys stuff?
Good question.
I know that the singer produces with the producer. I'm terrible with this. I should remember.
Me too.
No, please leave the comments below and tell us who does it, because I completely blank it.
Here I am saying that, oh, I love the way that these records sound, and I can't name who produced it either. But yeah, the Black Keys stuff, it sounds amazing to me. So I should go and look who produced it. I've always thought it sounded amazing.
Well, it's wonderful. What are your speakers?
Those are Klipsch.
Oh, wow. And you're driving that with what's your parent?
It's a Hafler Pro 5000, which is in the other room in there. We can take a look in there if you want.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Let's do a quick little summation on some of these keys and stuff like that.
Sure.
So these are the new little Yamahas you were just talking about.
There's four of these. I'm a proud owner of two of them. And they're all called Reface. And the reason why they're called Reface is because they're modeling older Yamaha technology. So the CP, this is their digital piano technology. And these are all portable keyboards. They run on batteries, or you can also use AC to plug them in. They have little speakers on them, so you can take them to the beach and fool around with them, and it's great because they're tactile and you can make tone. This is the CS, and this is modeled after their older analog synthesizers, and these will all plug in via USB to an iOS device and will allow you to save presets. So they don't have any preset memory on board, but you can still, if you make a sound that you think is cool, you can just plug in the iPad and capture the sound, and you can even give it one of those QR codes.
That's great.
And you can actually share the QR codes online, which is cool, because if you go online, you can see that people are sharing their Reface, you know, programs all over the place, which
I love
is really,
the way
really
they
cool.
Look.
Yeah, they're amazing. And there's two others. There's a DX, and then there's one model called the YC, which is modeled after their organ, which is a red one. So super cool.
Do we have this on earlier? Can we?
Yeah, I think it shuts off by itself, so we'll just repower it up.
We're already going to listen, obviously, through our little lapel mics, but
yeah.
That's great. That's like Zeppelin. That's Rain Song.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The other.
I do know how to play it. Yeah. Right? Those are good. Yeah. So it's definitely very, very musical, and you because of the tactile surface, you can just make lots of cool sounds very quickly. Reverb, you can change.
I like these little speakers. I'd probably mic these because they're so kind of crappy in a good way.
Exactly. Let's turn these off. So you got toy piano, clav, like a whirly, these are Rhodes. Tremolo. That's great. And then this guy, this is more of their analog thing. This is a little bit of a weirder. Yeah. More of a weirder synth, but you can do all kinds of crazy stuff with this too.
I love this.
It's got a little looper in it so you can record stuff.
These are the multi effects.
Yep. Got a little pitch bend.
Hours of fun.
Yeah, that's what's great about this. And once you get a tone that you like, iPad's got an app on it, and it's just the Reface Capture app. Download it for free and. It's like, oh, if I like the sound, you just capture it in there, give it a name. You can take a picture of the settings right in the app, and then you can assign it a QR code.
That's
and
great.
Yeah.
Is this monophonic or just set to monophonic at the moment?
Oh, it's just set there. You can change all that using these little faders right here. But it does have polyphony. See, this here it says poly.
Oh, I see.
So you can do. And this gives you the portamento setting, or if you want straight monophonic, you just set it right there. Or poly. Now you got poly.
Great.
Yeah.
Very nice indeed.
Endless tone-making devices.
Oh, I love fun things like that.
This is a Eurorack modular synthesizer. So what's cool about this is just a case, basically. It's a powered case. And all of these little sections, if you will, are individual modules that you can buy individually and separately, and you can sort of, it's like a buffet, you can build your own modular synthesizer.
And did you pick the ones that you wanted?
That's right, pick the ones that I wanted, and mixing and matching. This Moog Mother 32 is a relatively new, it's actually brand new semi-modular synthesizer, and it's also Eurorack compatible. So Eurorack is the format, and that's basically a cabling system underneath this case. If you take these panels off, there are these ribbon cables down there that have specific formatting to them, and anything that is Eurorack compatible, you can just pop into this case. They're all this size. And you just plug it in, and now you've got a whole, it's like building a pedal board.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
I love it.
It appeals to my engineering mind as well, because you can just do all kinds of crazy patching and feeding signals
TT
into
cables.
Each other. These are actually these little mono eighth inch cables. Yeah.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
A lot less expensive than TT cables.
The world's most expensive cable.
Yeah, it's
and
ridiculous.
Smallest. It
yeah, is you're
ridiculous.
Like, here's 10 cables, $200. You're like, what?
Exactly.
Yeah, crazy. And then what are these kind of little Auratone looking things?
Yeah, so those are the Chris Polonis Model 42 speakers. Chris Polonis is, have you heard of Chris Polonis speakers?
I haven't.
Yeah, so he's just a speaker manufacturer, and his stuff is just amazing sounding, and I was turned on to them by this gentleman at Westlake Pro. He said, I was looking for a pair of near fields, and he said, well, you should give these a try, and he let me take them home and try them out for a few days, and I just fell in love with them immediately.
Well, how would you describe them? Are they sort of better sounding Auratones?
Absolutely. Better sounding, more balanced, I would say. Although the Auratones obviously have their purpose, because they make you work really hard to get good sound. These do the same thing. They're a very balanced and flat speaker, but they just give you a bit more of a satisfying sort of sound when it's all said and done.
And where was your studio base?
It was in North Hollywood.
It was called
Seasound, Seasound. No relation to the company that was around for a little bit that was making gear called Seasound, even though they stole our name.
We tried. I don't know the name.
I think they're off the map. I think they had like one piece of gear and then they fell off the map. But anyway, Seasound was the name for the studio. It was in North Hollywood. It was right near Circus Liquors. And I was there for 14 years.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
And now you're doing everything here.
I do everything here. Like I mentioned before, I go to tracking studios in the Valley pretty frequently to record drums and do things, you know, take advantage of like their larger spaces and rooms, and then I get it back here. And if I've got programming or keyboard work to do, I typically do all that here. And then the mixing, I do all that here as well.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. Well, it's great. What I think is going to be great is that people are watching this and understanding that you had commercial studios, and now yeah. it's like we were talking to Barry Rudolph. You know Barry. He's the kind right. of the gear guru guy. He does a lot of magazine reviews of stuff. So I really respect his opinion. And what I like about you and guys like Barry is that you've had experience of all the different yeah. equipment. So when you come here, you have just a few choice things. You know, yeah. of when you had $500,000 worth of equipment, right. you know which 50 grand's worth of equipment to use.
Exactly.
What was superfluous right. and what was actually something that yeah. you were using every day?
That's right. Yeah. You know, obviously having, you know, I'm a big microphone hobbyist, I'll call it. You know, if I had unlimited income, I think I would buy microphones and I would buy analog keyboards. And, you know, obviously in a space like this, I really don't need more mic preamps because I'm not recording. If I had to record drums all the time, well, that would be a necessity. I would need more mic pre's. And when I had the commercial studio, I had a whole bunch of mic pre's. I didn't have just two of those. I had 12 of them. But when I was downsizing, I didn't need to have all that stuff because I didn't record all those signals at the same time in this location right here.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, I can't imagine a family would like a 12-piece drum kit out there with a gong in the front
exactly.
room.
That's right. Did I tell you that I worked with Terry Bozzio one time? Speaking of like
12 pieces of drums.
It was way more than 12 pieces, but that was one of the craziest recording experiences I ever had. Just because he came in with this humongous drum set and the nature of the music that he was playing on was very much meat and potatoes. And
Kick and snare.
Yeah, I think he used kick and snare. And I was actually kind of bummed because I wanted to watch him do like crazy stuff on all his stuff. And then when I realized it was just going to be kind of a straight ahead rock thing, I was like, oh man. It's a bummer.
I worked with Vinny Carluta, who's, I think I probably pronounced his name wrong there. And Vinny's incredible, but he comes in with like a Gretsch kit with, what was it, Ludwig. I think it was a Ludwig kit and Peisty cymbals. It was a rack and a floor.
Mm-hmm.
And he made it sound like yeah. he had 24 drums.
Oh, I'm sure.
But he didn't have 24 drums. Yeah. I mean, he was pretty phenomenal. He's one of the only drummers that played a lock that didn't bother me.
Right.
Because he could talk to you and play like,
right.
like softly like this right. and be like, yeah, well, I was thinking. And rather than going like this, he could just, his dynamics were insane.
Yeah.
And he could just sit there and have a conversation and play so lightly.
Right.
I mean, I remember being a guitar player, I grew up obsessed with great guitar players. And one of them was Holdsworth in the 80s. Alan Holdsworth was like, you know, when he was playing all that legato stuff through the 70s and 80s, nobody was doing it as well. And Vinny would play on stuff like that, and it would be like, there's a four. He would like hold down a four and play a five over it and a three, and just like my head would explode. He could just make it sound like three yeah. drummers playing.
Yep.
So, but yeah, so cool. the moral of that story is you don't need a lot of drums if you can.
If you can play them, yeah.
If you can play like
and
Vinny.
And tying it back into the gear, you don't need a lot of gear if you know what to do with
if
the gear that you
to,
have. That's
yeah,
right.
Great. Well, thanks, Evan. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Warren. I appreciate it.
As ever, please leave loads of comments and questions below. If there's anything specific to Evan, I'll try and hit him up and get answers. Thank you ever so much for watching. You know, I hope you enjoyed this studio tour, because the thing about Evan is he comes from a commercial world and he's been able to use like any piece of equipment that he's ever wanted, and now he's got the choice pieces. And I love this because it helps us realize that, you know, we don't need a lot, we just need the right pieces of equipment. And thank you so much for watching. Have a marvelous time, and speak to you soon.